Today, I wanted to talk a little bit about what might be at the root of addiction. I've talked a little bit about it before, but I wanted to give you some very specific questions to consider to see if there might be something else going on. Now, before I get into that, if you enjoy the videos on my channel, please make sure you subscribe. There's new videos every Tuesday and every Thursday. Simply hit the subscribe button and the bell notification, and you'll be alerted as soon as there's any new content. So let's talk a little bit about what might be going on. I see a lot of people who quit drinking, and in the early days, they feel great. They feel really happy. They feel calmer. They feel more peaceful in their lives. And they know that it's a wonderful decision and they're never going to go back to drinking again. The same happened for me. But after a few months, they can feel flat. They can feel like there's still something going on, that they don't feel quite right or completely at peace in their life. And this is where I wanted to talk a little bit more around what else is there that's laying underneath that. And through my own journey, I've managed to find out exactly what was going on and exactly where this comes from. And the same applies for so many people. And it's important to understand that in a lot of cases, alcohol addiction or any other kind of addiction is the effect. It's not necessarily the cause. That's not to say that alcohol or any other form of addiction is not addictive. Of course it is. But often we're looking for a way to soothe ourselves, to avoid uncomfortable pain, emotions or feelings that we just don't want to face up to. And we can end up living an existence as our false self. Now, the false self is the version of us that we present to the rest of the world. And if you're presenting a false self, it can leave you feeling really uncomfortable. An example might be somebody who posts pictures of their holiday all over Facebook to get likes and approval and attention. But actually, the holiday was bad. It wasn't like the pictures showed. They spent the whole time arguing with their partner and their kids, and they had a terrible time. But they didn't post a picture of that. They weren't true. And I wouldn't recommend posting a picture of that. I'm just giving you an example. We need to become the true version of ourselves. And when we're our false selves, we end up putting the things that we fail to acknowledge about us into our shadow. We don't acknowledge it. We ignore it. We pretend it doesn't exist. A great example might be if you judge other people. And let's be honest, most of us do that. If you judge other people, but don't accept that it's something you do, then you've put it in your shadow. You've not acknowledged that that is who you are and that's something that you do. Subsequently, when we put something in our shadow, it tends to come back and bite us. So when we find ourselves in a situation where somebody is judgmental towards us, we have an irrational reaction. We become overwhelmed by emotion. And it's all because we've put our own judgment into our shadow. We fail to acknowledge that that's something we do. We're living a false self existence. Whereas if we acknowledge that on occasion I judge other people, it wouldn't hurt or make us suffer if somebody was to judge us. Now, they're just a couple of examples. It can happen with just about any kind of emotion, situation, or any feeling that might come up. So try to be the true and authentic version of yourself. When you feel pain or hurt or discomfort within, try to see where it's coming from. Try and express it. And I'm going to go into a bit more detail about exactly where I think this is coming from. But first of all, I just wanted to ask you some questions. I've got 30 questions here. I will go through them quickly, don't worry. And I just want to see if you nod your head to any of them. If they make you say, yeah, that's me, I do that. Because if they do, I think I can probably signpost you and direct you towards exactly where this is coming from. And I think it will really, really help you, especially if you've quit drinking, you've had an amazing time in the early days, and then things have gone really flat. You're finding that you've got an urge to drink again. You still don't feel like the normal version of yourself that you want to feel. You're not really at peace. You're not completely calm. I almost guarantee that there's something else going on, and we need to get to the bottom of that. And this is all about ripping it up at the roots. We're not just chopping off a few branches. We need to find out what's going on underneath that. So let me ask you these questions, and let's see how many of them you find yourself nodding to, and then I'll explain a bit more about what to do if you found yourself saying, yeah, that's me, to those questions. There's 30 of them. Let's go for it. I'm just going to look at the other screen while I read them out. So the first one is, you have a feeling that something is wrong, but you don't know what it is. The next one, number two, you have a feeling that you are hollow inside, that you are empty, or you have a void within you. I absolutely felt like that. Third one, people tell you that you have a lack of empathy. The next one is, you often feel sad, unhappy, or down for no obvious reason. The next one is, you have trouble understanding or feeling your emotions. The next one, you find it hard to motivate yourself. You struggle with self-discipline. You are a people pleaser and have difficulty saying no to others. You feel that your happiness is dependent on other people. You experience unpredictable moods or regular mood swings. You experience a feeling of helplessness at times. You've been told that you're needy, possessive, or clingy. You feel like you're a fake or a fraud. That might be in your work or with hobbies or activities. You experience regular negative self-talk. You often judge yourself more harshly than you judge other people. You prefer the company of animals to other people. You are rarely fully present in the current moment. You can have aggressive or angry outbursts. We're nearly there, don't worry. You have irrational emotional responses to certain situations, people, or events. You experience addictive behavior. That could be alcohol, drugs, gambling, online shopping, exercising, porn, sex, you name it. But if you have a tendency towards addictions, then this one applies to you. You have a sense of being numb to your feelings. You have an expectation of perfectionism. How many of us have that? You are easily emotionally overwhelmed. You have difficulty interpreting the emotions and expectations of other people as well as yourself. You struggle to express your emotions and feelings in a healthy way. You have trouble being able to relax. You find it difficult to become still, reflective, calm, and silent. And the last one is, you struggle reaching out for help when you need it. So that's 30 questions there. I would love to hear in the comments, please comment on the video and let me know how many of those were true for you and you found yourself nodding your head at them. It might have been zero, or it might have been absolutely loads of them. I know that when I first went through a similar process, I found myself nodding at almost every question. And I discovered through that experience that what was really going on for me was that I was hiding away and suppressing emotions and feelings and discomfort, hurt, suffering from when I was younger. There was a lot of things went on when I was a child. There was emotional neglect, there was trauma, there was abandonment, there was rejection. You might have heard me talk about it before. And I had never faced up to it. I was living as my full self. I was projecting onto the world that everything was fine. I was living a really happy life. But actually, in my shadow was all the suffering and the pain from when I was younger. And the first step to moving forward was to acknowledge that that was going on, to accept that these things had happened. I actually drew out a timeline of my life with all of the events and all of the things that have caused me pain and suffering, as well as all the good things as well. I put it all on there. And then I worked through it. I tried to make sense of it. And as I went forward, I began to connect with my feelings. And I can give some strategies for that to help you reconnect and to start to feel feelings and to healthily express your emotions, because that really is so important. But for me, this process was all about creating a sense of awareness. So going forward, I began to notice the feelings that I was having. And instead of just reacting to them and becoming overwhelmed, I would take a moment. I'd pause. I would ask myself What is it I really need in this moment? What am I asking for? And then I would also try and trace back the feelings. Whenever there was an overwhelming feeling, it really does point to a childhood reaction. There's a phrase that says, when it's hysterical, it's historical. So if you have a hysterical reaction, the chances are that it relates to something in your history, in your past. When those happen to me, and they happen quite often, I would look at what it was that had caused that to happen. So it might be the way that somebody has spoken to me, or somebody may have ignored me or become angry with me. And that's caused this emotional reaction to stir within me. It's become overwhelming, and I've had a hysterical, overwhelming emotional response to it. When that happened, I would then use my journal. I'd take the time to try and trace it back and to try and understand it and make sense of it. When I was able to make sense of it, and often it was things to do with rejection, abandonment, criticism, some of the things that I've experienced from my parents and in at points in my childhood, when I was able to make sense of it, it all began to make sense. And I stopped putting those things in my shadow because I was acknowledging them, I was accepting them, and I was able to stop being my false self and start to become my true self. And when you're not carrying around all that baggage, you feel so much lighter. When you're being your false self all the time, you're kind of living a phony existence, and it is draining. You might not even realize it because we don't do it consciously, which is why I wanted to give you some very clear questions so you can begin to work this out and to then start to take some steps to move down the right path, which is very much around reconnecting with the child you have within you, your inner child. That child is probably hurt. It was probably neglected, traumatized, or suffered in some way when you were young, but you can heal it. I'm actually writing a book about this at the moment, but it's not going to be out for a while. You can heal that inner child. And when you do, it's an amazing and beautiful thing, because believe me, so many of us are avoiding connecting with that inner child, facing up to the true version of ourselves and experiencing the real feelings and the real emotions that we've got going on in favor of addictive behavior. And it's simply a defense mechanism, an avoidance technique in order to not have to look in the mirror at the real version of ourselves. But it's when we look into those dark places that we actually find the light, and we become able to wear our insides, which is the truth and the real version of us, on the outside. When you can do that, you become free, you become light. There is a whole lot more to this topic, and I'm going to do some other videos around it. And as I say, I'm writing about it at the moment. But do feel free to write to me, email me, if you want to explore this in a bit more depth. But for now, I want to just make you aware, allow you to start exploring this, shine some light on what might be going on. If you're finding that you've quit drinking and actually you still don't feel great, you still got an urge to drink, because at the end of the day, alcohol probably isn't the problem. Alcohol might be the effect, but I doubt that it's the cause. We need to get to the cause. The cause in almost every case lies back in our childhood. And you might think you had the perfect childhood, but in many cases, the type of emotional neglect that I talk about is very subtle, and it's certainly not intentional. In almost every case, our parents love us. They loved us. They thought we were wonderful, or think we're wonderful if they're still around, but they weren't fully equipped to do the job that they'd taken on. They were absent without leave in many cases on an emotional level. That certainly was the case for me. It doesn't mean that they don't love you. So don't think about blaming or pointing the finger at anybody in this. This is simply a process of discovery and understanding. And it's that discovery, that awareness, that understanding that is going to lead you to something incredible and amazing. And personally, I think the best place to approach this from is when you're sober. Because when you don't drink, you're already calmer, you're already less fazed by things that used to overwhelm you. So you're in a wonderful position to begin exploring your history, looking at your story, looking at the timeline of your life, and trying to trace things back, join up the dots, and work out exactly what's going on for you. I'm just going to leave you with one last thing. There's different types of parents, and I do get some people who say to me, I had the perfect childhood, Simon. Everything was wonderful. There's no way there was any kind of emotional neglect or poor behavior on the part of my parents. As I say, this can be an invisible enemy. It's a bit like a ghost. We don't even realize that it's going on. I'm just going to share a few of the common types of parents where emotional neglect can take place. And that might enable you to recognize that actually this is something that's affected you when maybe you thought you had a perfect upbringing. And once again, this is not about parents loving or not loving anyone. This is all about you, about putting yourself first and becoming the true version of you. You have to remember that these kind of behaviors are handed down from generation to generation. If we have an aggressive, angry parent, the chances are that they had an aggressive, angry parent. And the chances are we will become an aggressive, angry parent. This is an opportunity for you to stop this in its tracks and change the game and write a new story. It's so incredibly powerful. I'm just going to look at my other screen to read to you a little bit about the different types of parents. So the first type is called the me first parent. That type of parent literally puts themselves first. Their needs are over and above everybody else in the family, including their kids. This one's kind of obvious and you probably would notice it, but these type of parents can leave their children as they become adults with issues around self-worth. They're prone to depression and anxiety. They can have problems forming intimate relationships. They can have difficulty expressing feelings and emotions, and they can be really easily triggered by similar behaviors. So when people around them are putting themselves first, not thinking of others, that can trigger someone who had that kind of parent as well. Adult children of these parents can also feel incredibly insecure. They can have problems trusting other people, and they can be prone to forming codependent relationships too. One of the hardest types of parents to spot where emotional neglect is going on is the type of parent that I had, which is the permissive parent. Now, the permissive parent can often be seen as the cool parent. We all had friends who had the cool parent at school. They're the parents who let their kids stay up really late. They might let their kids hang out in unsuitable places or do things that other children aren't allowed to do. They're permissive. Those parents often also fail to set boundaries. In my own case, I would often do no better than average in my grades at school. But the message I received from my permissive parents was that was enough. I was doing my best. So I was left thinking as a child that middle of the road is my best. I'm no better than that. There was never any boundaries. There was never any pushing. And there were certainly never any consequences. Although my parents actually crossed over into some of the other categories. So most of the time they were permissive, but on other occasions they would be quite strict or they would be controlling, which gave me a whole bunch of messages. So don't think that each parent fits perfectly into each category. They can cross over and there can be different elements in there. But I'll just read you a little bit about the permissive parents. As I say, they often don't let their children see that there's consequences for their behavior. They rarely set boundaries. They'll let children think that however badly or well they're performing, that that's good enough. A child who has a permissive parent might come home with a really bad school report and they're not even worried about it because they know that mum and dad aren't going to be bothered or take an interest. They just let things slide. And they don't properly parent their children by setting expectations, pushing them when it's appropriate to do so. And as I say, setting boundaries is such a big one. And the negative effects that can have, it can create a sense of insecurity in the adult version of the child. They can also have problems setting boundaries themselves. They can have a selfish nature. They can dislike sharing. They can be irresponsible and take risks when they become older. They often fail to take responsibility for their own behavior. They can have poor self-control and poor self-regulation. And they can have poor social skills. And they can sometimes show antisocial behavior. Adult children of permissive parents can also have problems with authority figures. And they can also lack self-discipline too. The next type of parent is the absent or uninvolved parent. So this could be a parent who's a workaholic or a parent who's away for long periods of time, maybe if they're in the military and they were posted somewhere or they went off on exercise, those parents just aren't around. They would be the perfect parents if they were there. And this can leave children with all sorts of issues going on that they carry forward into adult life. And of course, there's lots of other situations. If there's a divorce, for example, there's not only going to be issues around abandonment and rejection, you're also going to end up with a parent who is much less involved. They're just simply not going to be around as much as they might have been or as much as the child needs them to be in order to have their needs met. And this can leave children with difficulty expressing their feelings and their emotions, low self-esteem. They can be quite needy in terms of what they want emotionally from people. They can be quite clingy. They can have a tendency to seek love and attention and approval from others. They can have difficulty sustaining healthy relationships, difficulty with social interaction, problems with decision-making, and a lack of healthy coping skills. The next parent is the struggling parent, and a struggling parent often ends up emotionally neglecting their parent because they've just got so much going on in their own lives. They're not bad people, and in fact, none of these parents are bad people. They love their children, and a lot of this is kind of covert. It's very subtle. It's just something that happens in the background, and we tend not to notice it. So a struggling parent might be suffering from illness. They might have a disabled relative or sibling to look after. They might have a disabled relative or one of their other children to look after. They might be struggling with depression, or they might have other problems going on in their life that might be overwhelming and preventing them from being truly emotionally connected with their child. In some cases, the struggling parent and their child end up swapping roles. The child becomes the parent, they're looking after them, making sure that they're okay, and the struggling parent effectively becomes the child. They're being parented by their own child. And this can continue into adulthood. As the child becomes an adult, they're still finding that they're chained to their parent, that they're responsible for them. And that can lead to a sense of resentment and present its own challenges as we get older. So children of struggling parents, they tend to find that some of the issues they'll experience as they get older are that they become incredibly self-sufficient, which can be a good thing as well. But they can also become very guarded because they've learned to be self-sufficient and get on with things on their own. They've struggled to express emotions and feelings and connect with the true version of themselves. They just bottle everything up, stiff upper lip, get on with it. So they tend to keep everything inside. They don't express externally. That can be a major problem. They also tend to have a strong sense of empathy for other people. They want to help other people, and they often put other people's needs ahead of their own. And this whole video, this whole process is all about starting to put your own needs first, because it's so, so important. We've spent far too long pleasing people, far too long putting others' needs ahead of our own. It's time to start putting ourselves first. So if that sounds familiar, this is time to do something about it. And those children of struggling parents can also have problems with relationships and problems with intimacy. Now, there are some other type of parents. There are parents who struggle with addictions. There are parents who are violent and abusive, like directly violent and abusive. There can be sexual abuse, violence specifically as well, and verbal abuse too. So there's a whole bunch of other parenting styles. Those are the most common, and I just wanted to give you an overview and an indication of what some of those parenting styles look like. If you're thinking, actually, my childhood was fine, but I still feel flat after I've quit drinking. I still don't feel quite right. And it feels like there's something else going on. I really urge you to start exploring this in more depth, looking at it with a real close eye and a sense of curiosity to find out where it's all coming from. Because in my personal experience and the experience of many people that I've worked with, it is usually a case of finding what is existing within our shadows, looking at the false version of ourselves, looking at the timeline of our life, tracing back our feelings and emotions to see where they're really coming from, getting an understanding of our parents, making sense of the things that happened to us when we were younger, and then putting some safe boundaries in place, understanding who the toxic people are in your life, what are the toxic places, the things that might trigger you emotionally. What does that all look like? Start to put some safe boundaries in place, put yourself first, start protecting yourself, and you can start to heal this and you can come out the other side. And when you do, believe me, you feel a million times lighter, a million times happier, and you won't feel hollow inside or empty or have this overriding sense of permanent sadness. It is so, so important that you look at this. So much so, as I say, I'm writing a book. And I'm not going to tell you the title because it's got a swear word in it. I might just flash it up on the screen, actually. Yeah, I will. So if you stayed right to the end of the video, you've had a little bit of an exclusive there. So hopefully that gives you some insight. Please do reach out to me if you want to talk about this or explore it further. I've got my own personal experience, which I want to share with as many people as possible because I think it will help. And do comment in the video as well if you notice that you were saying yes to a lot of those questions that I asked, the 30 questions earlier on in the video.